In our studio today are two very distinguished guests, a composer and a pianist. The composer is John Corigliano, 30 or 31?
31.
31. And the pianist is Hilde Sommer, and I won't ask the same question there because I think she's not 30 yet, and besides, it's not polite to discuss a lady's age on the air. Miss Sommer has been playing piano in this country for years, however, because I very well remember when she started out really entitled to the label of child prodigy. Now, all of a sudden, these two artists and musicians are joined in a single project because Mr. Corigliano has delivered himself of a piano concerto. Is this your first concerto, by the way,
yes,
for any instrument?
Yes, it is. I've written solo works and chamber works and orchestral works, but the problem of a concerto, which is a group of many problems, I've never faced before. It's really exciting.
If you do not have any objections to your background in the matter of being aired, however, I think I should say that as the son of a longtime concert master of the New York Philharmonic Orchestra by the name of Corigliano, you are well aware of the problems and the possibilities in the field of the concerto. Though your father is a violinist, could hardly have introduced you to piano concertos. Are you a pianist yourself?
No, my mother's a pianist. And
what is your instrument? All of them.
All of them, yeah. No, I fake the piano. I don't really play well, and if anyone's around, I play terribly. But alone, when the doors are closed, I can do some marvelous things.
Having listened to your concerto, I know perfectly well then that you can't play it, because it is tough piece. Miss Sommer gave the world premiere of this concerto of John Corigliano's in San Antonio, Texas, with the orchestra there under Victor D'Alessandro.
Right, Victor Alessandro.
Alessandro, in 68, wasn't it? 19.
It was at the opening of the Hemisphere
in San Antonio.
It was commissioned by the orchestra, and it opened the beautiful new theater which they built at the occasion of Hemisphere.
A question I would like to ask Miss Sommer, one that has occurred to me before, but I don't remember ever asking any artist about it before, would be this. At what point in the history of this concerto did you decide, or did you know that you were going to play it? Had you played other music of Mr. Corigliano's? Just how does this work? I know an artist in a career such as yours is always looking for a new work of substance, one they can believe in and that they can show off in and that they can take around. When did you first begin to know that you were going to play the Corigliano concerto?
Well, let me think. What were the dates? The opening of the theater in Hemisphere was just a little over a year ago. But 5 months prior to that, my manager had a call, would I like to premiere John Corigliano's piano concerto? Because I had heard of him, but I said, well, I'd like to see the score. Well, there's no score. It's not going to be ready until maybe 3 months before the concert.
Mm-hmm.
Well, how do you decide? Of course, I said, I'd like to hear something Mr. Corigliano has written. So Mr. Corigliano invited me over for cocktails to his
apartment. That's a good way to begin, yes.
And he played me the tape of the violin sonata, which Mr. Corigliano Sr. had just recorded.
With Ralph Vodopek, I think.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I was just crazy about mm-hmm. the work, and I said, fine, if your piano concerto is as good, I will be very happy to play it.
I think that's a fascinating beginning. Now, when you got the score, and by the way, did it come a movement at a time, or did
yes.
you get it all at once?
No one ever gets it all at once. I got a movement at a time, and it wasn't even chronological, if I remember
no,
right.
No, it was, I think. Yes, it was chronological, but the last movement arrived page by page.
The
really?
Last movement,
well, just about,
I don't
yes.
think, was copied until 2 weeks before
yeah,
the concert.
It was a scramble. I think this happens an awful lot, and it certainly happened in this case.
Well, Beethoven started this tradition a long time ago.
I heard an opera of Penderecki's in Santa Fe a few weeks ago, and they were making changes at 7 o'clock in the evening when it was to begin yeah. at 9 that night. They were still making changes.
It's very
it's not
good
unusual,
for yet. One's nerves.
Well, then you can make your own changes, I should think, as you go along. Did you play everything? Maybe I shouldn't ask. Did
yes,
you play everything Mr. Corigliano
ask.
Wrote?
I played everything and more.
Did you make some changes?
Well,
how did the work look to you? Now, after all, those who are listening to us tonight are going to hear the concerto, and they can decide, they will have a certain number of reactions and responses of their own. But when you first began to play it, how did it seem to you? As a pianist who's played the whole range of concerto repertoire, does it fit the piano? Does it fit your hands? What were its technical problems
well,
for you?
I liked it immediately.
It's a big, exciting piece, and you
very
like big, exciting music.
Very
yes.
musical and powerful and tremendous dramatic impact and lyricism. It is a work which has so much espressivo quality, which is unusual in modern music. And although, as you know, I play a lot of modern music, I tend to play only music which communicates impact, feeling, emotion, excitement. I don't like anything that is mathematical, dogmatic, looks good on paper and doesn't sound good. When you read a lot of new music, you have a way of looking at a note picture and you get a sound picture, and I loved the piece right from the first. I did find it very difficult, and talking about what lies in one hand on the keyboard sometimes doesn't lie on somebody else's keyboard hand. Now, Mr. Corigliano happens to have a hand which spans about 13 notes without extending it very much, and my hand only spanning 10 notes, because had certain problems. And when you work on a new piece, you have to have meetings with the composer, and I had certain suggestions, and Mr. Corigliano was very generous, said, "Oh, that sounds very good. Anything that you can do to bring out the meaning or the line."
I think that what Hill is saying, and I think what's so important about this, is that I'm interested in the sound, and when I write something on the paper, it is nothing until the sound is made. And of course, this is a whole philosophy of writing. And when Hilda has problems, say, with the size of one hand, the size of another, something of that kind, an adjustment is the only way, because what you're trying to get is a result, not a process of note exact note getting, you see. That isn't what this is all about.
No, it's a communication. If the hands can't bring it out at any point in the piano, and that also is involved, whether it's in the treble, if it'll speak through the orchestra and so forth, it doesn't work.
Speaking to the orchestra, though, of course, is my problem in a way, in the sense of writing a piece that has a single instrument versus nearly 100 other players and having them heard. And this is, of course, the problem of a concerto, is the battle between the two and yet having a sense of excitement and sound in both.
Well, the thing is, I do feel that most people don't span 13 notes.
No, those, I don't think so. Scriabin did.
I was going to say, your colleague Alexander Scriabin did, and most people have tremendous trouble playing Scriabin, and you are free to arrange certain things to suit your hand and your technical capacity. After all, Mozart said, play with your nose if you have to, and so did Chopin.
Yes.
You have to have an extra long nose for that. But in any case, all I'm saying is that as long as you get the sound, how you do it, something else.
Right.
Now, that was one of the problems. And the other thing, when you learn a new concerto and you don't know what the orchestra is going to sound like and how it is going to be in ensemble, that is the big excitement and adventure. Because first you learn your own part and you look at the score and you visualize in your mental ear what it's going to sound like, but it's never the same. Even to the composer, it's not the same.
There's a great deal of writing in your concerto in which there are some rather striking and unusual sounds, for instance, from the percussion section. You can't visualize precisely the balance between the piano and the rest of the orchestra until you can get into an orchestra rehearsal, I should think.
Absolutely, and then certain instruments take more time to produce a sound, And the whole thing is completely off from what you picture it's going to be.
Is there any point nowadays in a concerto such as yours, for instance, in working through it with a second piano? Is that just simply something you do with older concertos?
No. We tried that, and it is possible. It's very difficult. And now that the concerto has been played, of course, it's much easier for both of us to do this. In the first rehearsals, especially the cadenzas for piano and percussion, we had enormous problems. Do you tap on the piano? Do you hit little cluster sounds in imitation of percussion? All these things had to be solved.
And the timing of that is particularly delicate. Did you have to replace, did you have to relocate any sections of the orchestra for this?
No.
We would have liked to have done it, but it's not possible to have the percussion section run up front and then chase back into the rear of the stage. Well, it's very difficult for the conductor, I think, because the percussion, there were five percussion players playing the opening cadenza of the concerto and then the recapitulation of the cadenza. And it is simply fantastic to play with a xylophone, play duos with a xylophone and do the same asymmetrical wild rhythms. They're all irregular.
Yes.
And not are they irregular for the given instrument, but they overlap. Where I have the downbeat, he will have the second beat of an eighth note. It's really very complicated. But if you have good musicians, you finally, after you count it and you do your homework, it's your ear which finally tells you what to do.
And the conductor is the coordinating.
And the conductor stands there helpless, helplessly, and hopes for the best.
And waits to see if his musicians and you can put it together.
Right. Uh-huh. But it does come to a point when you just have to listen to each other.
Did either of you have to make or want to make any major changes from that which you had originally planned, either in your writing of the concerto or in your playing of certain passages, when you were able to work it with the orchestra?
Well, the only thing that I can think of that was a major change, I made two cuts in the piece. The first one, they were both in the third movement. First one was suggested by Samuel Barber, who heard the piece and liked mm-hmm. it very much. And his only comment about the whole thing was he wished that the serenity of the third movement could begin a little sooner than it had. I had a very agitated beginning, and I extended it. And I thought about this, and I thought he was right, because it comes right after a scherzo, which is extremely agitated. So I cut the opening passage to reveal the piano sooner, playing its legato and beautiful, soft and
well, that was the only change, though. I didn't make any changes. I like the structure. It's architecturally a beautiful work, isn't it?
I'm fascinated that you say that, though, because when I listened to the concerto the first time, I remember distinctly being very grateful for the fact that the third movement began that way,
yes.
without knowing that you began it at all. I had been interested in the precise architectural appearance of the work. For those who haven't heard it yet, and I guess this is our whole audience, there are three movements, an opening allegro and a closing movement, which, however, begins with this serene passage Mr. Corigliano has just spoken of. It's marked, if I remember, Andante Espressivo,
right,
or something
like
that.
And that actually is a combination of two movements in a way, but it is one long movement.
Yes, it's not really a four-movement concerto at all, but the Andante part
leads
opens
into,
the final
right,
movement
opens
and then
the final
returns
movement.
It to a very stormy, energetic allegro again.
Right.
And this scherzo is just about 2.5 to 3 minutes long in right. the middle between the two. It separates them. They are almost exactly the same size as far as
yes.
time goes.
Yes.
And it is a striking passage because there's been a great deal of business in the opening movement, but the scherzo is delicately written.
Yes,
and
in fact,
fleet.
I must tell you, I wrote it to break tension. It was an interesting mm-hmm. thing. The first movement is very emotional, as I'm sure you
yes.
have heard, and I wanted something cool, something, because you see, the slow movement builds to a huge emotional climax, and then the last movement, well, the second part of the slow movement is tremendously energetic. So I wanted something cool to relax one almost and yet have a sense of scurrying, but very quiet scurrying.
Well, it's mm-hmm. very jazzy.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it
and
is.
And it's terribly funny. It's
yes.
humorous.
Yes, yes, it's an ironic. Yeah.
But I don't think it's cool because nothing you write is cool,
well,
thank goodness.
Well, for me it's cool.
Cool may mean different things.
Oh.
Perhaps Mr. Corigliano is speaking of cool in the sense that some teenagers do nowadays. Mm-hmm. When they say cool it, man, cool
it. He doesn't
it,
have the clothes to match that meaning.
No, but then that could be underneath. There's some extraordinary scoring, if I remember correctly, in either the scherzo or in the slow passage that opens the third movement. I couldn't quite place it. I had the feeling there were some muffled cymbals or gongs or something that played quiet percussive chords along with the piano at certain sort of
yes.
intervals.
Well, you see
an
the
amazing
last,
sound.
I tell you, the last movement is built on the idea of cluster. And the idea of percussive clustering,
mm-hmm.
which is something that's been used quite a lot, but it appears first, actually, in the orchestra, just as a single muffled drum, and then other instruments are added as a bass drum, which has no pitch. Now, this no-pitched quality is carried to the ultimate, as far as it can go in terms of a bass sound. Other instruments join it. We have brass clusters joining it with the piano. We have string clusters down low. And finally, the piano does something that Hilda, when she first got it, she saw these bars straight across the piano right after she had played octaves, and we had to go through what that was, which
well,
was the dropping of the hand on the keys.
That is the invention of the day. This is a combination of playing regular chords and clusters
mm-hmm.
In one, practically one motion. It sounds like you play two instruments. In other words, you do your chord with your fingers, and then right after that you drop the palm of your hand on the keyboard.
Covering how many notes about?
As well, many as you can reach.
As many as you have.
But not the forearm. For
no,
instance.
No, no,
I mean,
no.
That goes back to Henry Cowell 40
exactly.
or 50
it is not
years
that
ago.
Kind of thing.
No.
It is precisely
no.
the opposite of that. It's a very controlled, sharp forearm.
Oh, I see.
Palm
yes.
cluster,
yes.
it really is.
Yes, we should have television now, and then our audience would see what we're all trying to do with the palms
well,
of
you
our
see,
hands.
The point is that this is not an effect, but this came out of the theme which opens
mm-hmm.
that movement, you
mm-hmm.
see, and it is a developmental process till finally it's revealed in the piano as its final role to play,
mm-hmm.
you see, and that's the point of it, is that it's a growth process into this. It isn't an effect that's just pulled out of the air to startle, but it's part of a development.
Miss Sommer, may I ask you not for to place this concerto in the midst of other concertos, but in general, we could use an exciting piano concerto like this these days, couldn't we? Now, you're slated to play the second concerto of Alberto Ginastera when Mr. Ginastera finishes it. I think a work that you're ready to play with the Indianapolis, well, I won't say ready to play, but scheduled to play with the Indianapolis
Symphony. I haven't
seen it yet,
but it's scheduled for January 1970.
Is this a long-time interest of yours in new concertos, or are you interested, as I might say I am, in seeing the contemporary concerto repertoire enlarged? There's no great number of distinguished piano concertos.
That is exactly what I'm interested in. People say, well, where's music going to go? Music will go on as long as people are going to be living. I believe in that. And I think that the modern composer needs encouragement, and our repertoire, as you say, Mr. Hume, needs enlargement. However, I think that a concerto like this, which has proven to be not only a success with the audience, but mm-hmm. also with critics, which is an unusual combination. Well, that is the ideal, if the very sophisticated, knowledgeable taste of a critic and the audience agree. Those are the works which survive, I would think. But I feel that Gian Corigliano's concerto is one of these rare works. It is a fiery work, and it's terribly effective on stage, and the musicians love playing it because it's difficult and it's a challenge and it's full of life and you have to be on your toes all the time. And it has another element which I love. It is very lyrical, and I think the time has come to get away from the percussive, harsh sounds which followed the romantic late 19th century, early 20th century, and took over and eradicated melody and feeling.
I don't know, but what we ought to let the lady have the last word, and I can't think of a better way to end this conversation about this new concerto, which our listeners will hear shortly, than with that comment by Miss Hilde Sommer. We've been delighted to have her in the studio. And Mr. Gian Corigliano, the composer of this concerto, thank you both again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your hospitality, Mr. Hume.